Good morning, Your Honors. Matt Campbell from the Federal Defenders of Eastern Washington and Idaho. On behalf of Jesse Barker, I'm going to try to reserve 3 minutes for rebuttal.
Okay.
In this case, the district court erroneously found that a prior conviction under 18 U.S.C. 922G for being a felon in possession of a firearm was a crime of violence. The court did so because it based that determination largely on the commentary to 2K2.1 and 4B1.2 rather than any recognized prong of the use of force.
You're talking about the application note?
Correct.
State commentary?
Yes, Your Honor.
Okay. Let me ask you a couple of questions about this. At this point, do I owe any discretion to the district court in this decision?
No, Your Honor.
We have interpretation of the guideline as de novo under Kimbrough. We have application of the guidelines to the facts as abuse of discretion under Kimbrough, and the factual determinations clear error. Is this an interpretation of the guidelines or an application of the guidelines to the facts?
It's an interpretation of the guidelines, Your Honor, subject to de novo review, because the issue is what are the bases that a prior conviction can be determined to be a crime of violence. And
right.
In this case,
so the next question I have, if it is de novo, if the district court incorrectly applies the sentencing guidelines and its error is not harmless, then we have to vacate. Is this harmless error? The sentencing range for the base offense of 20 is what?
At a 20, the base offense level would be, the guideline range in criminal history category 4 would be 51 to 63 months. However, Mr. Barker...
And what did he get?
Mr. Barker got 48 months.
So we're saying then there's no question that it's not harmless because he got 3 months less than he would have under the base... under the guideline range?
No, Your Honor. The base offense level was 20. However, he pled guilty. So he would have been sentenced at a 17. And at a 17, the offense level would be 37 to 46 months. So even at the high end of that range, he would have been looking at 2 months less than what he received. What Judge Nielsen actually did in this case was determine, we argue erroneously, that the range was 57 to 71 months, and then gave him the low end, and then varied downward by 9 months. If those same calculations were used, that would have resulted in a sentence of 28 months, and Mr. Barker would, in fact, be out of custody as of today.
Okay, so then if I look at 2K2.1A2, which, as I understand it, is the guideline, is the place where we have to go in making these determinations, and I look at 2K2.1A2, the application note to that particular guideline says a crime of violence has the meaning given that term in 4B1.2A, which you could argue, and I frankly think we'd have to agree with you to some extent, that court has found that guideline unconstitutional.
Correct.
So we got 4B1.2A, but the problem comes that it doesn't just say that. It says, and application note of the commentary. Reading that language, it doesn't suggest that 4B1.2, as interpreted by the application note, is what we're using. It suggests instead 4B1.2A and the application note. Is that a distinction that makes a difference in this case?
Your Honor, I don't think it does, and I think the reason why it doesn't is that at the time the commentary, the application note, was written, the residual clause was in essence considered valid.
Well, but just a second. If in fact, I mean, after I read this particular note, I read application notes in 2K1.3, in 2K2.1, S1.1, 3B1.5. I read all these different situations in the application notes, And it seems to me that in some they say and, and in some they say as interpreted by. Does that make a difference?
I don't think it does if we look to the Stinson case.
Is there a case that suggests it doesn't make a difference?
Well, I think that if we look at the Supreme Court case in Stinson, that says that where the text of a guideline and the commentary or the application notes contradict, it's the text of the guideline that controls. And if we look at the guidelines themselves, I believe it's 1B1.7, it says as much and cites to Stinson. So what we have here is a situation which through Johnson 2015, the residual clause is no longer valid, which means that under the text of the guideline, something can only be a crime of violence if it involves either the use of force or is one of the enumerated offenses. This clearly is neither. So therefore, the commentary amounts to an expansion of the text of the guideline, which is not authoritative by the Sentencing Commission, and Congress doesn't, in fact, approve those.
Well, let me think about this again. The Judge Fletcher, who did live here, not the one who's returned home to live where she lived, she wrote Barajas versus Wise. And in Barajas versus Wise, she had a similar situation. And she was trying to determine what to do with this kind of a problem. And she was, in fact, looking at 1101A43F and trying to determine whether it applied or whether the application note applied. It seemed to me, in reviewing that case, she came out differently, that she seemed to think that as if it's to be interpreted and that it is two different interpretations, both of which would be applicable. And if I go to and, you don't disagree with me, do you, that if I applied only the application note and not 4B1.2, this would be an appropriate sentence?
I think the analysis would be significantly more complicated.
Well,
and the question,
but I guess if I read the application note, it says a crime of violence does not include the offense of unlawful possession of a firearm by a felon. These are the most important words. Unless the possession of a firearm described in 26 U.S.C. 5854A, which is exactly this one. So the application note would suggest that for the possession of a firearm as indicated in 265845A, that is a crime of violence because it's a very dangerous way to possess the firearm. Now, so it seemed to me again, going back to where I was and trying to get you to help me, the term and in the application note for 2K2.1A2 is pretty important. I've either got to ignore that and for some reason, and I couldn't find a case that would suggest I should, or if I read it in, then it seems to me I've got a crime of violence, especially because you don't dispute that a Molotov cocktail is in fact a destructive device.
Your Honor, taking that at the end and then perhaps going backwards, I don't dispute that a Molotov cocktail in theory is a destructive device, but I do dispute whether Mr. Barker was ever convicted of that. Since he was only pled under 922G, the statement that there was a Molotov cocktail involved would be verbal surpluses at best that under DeCamp would not be part of the analysis that we would engage in. But I think to get to the court's fundamental question, which was the use of the word and.
Are you suggesting that it's not a divisible crime?
It is not a divisible crime, and the government concedes that 922G is not a divisible crime. So I think the fundamental question is how much of an import does the word and have? And again, I think at the time the guideline and the commentary was drafted, the and language perhaps made more sense because at the time the residual clause was considered valid. What we have now here
has nothing to do with the residual clause. It has all to do with whether you use the guideline, which is the 2K2.1A2, or whether you can use that and the application note. The application note doesn't talk about otherwise involves conduct that presents a serious potential risk.
But we've cited
the application note says there are possessions which are in fact crimes of violence.
What we've tried to do is cite a number of cases, specifically Shell, Stinson, and others, that stand for the proposition that once the residual clause is excised, the commentary that interpreted it is no good. And I would cite the court to the Soto Rivera case out of the First Circuit that was issued this year.
That's always a good point, and I appreciated your point until I thought to myself, if it's as interpreted by, I think his cases are dead on. But if it's not as interpreted by, and that's why I went to all these other application notes in all these other sections to determine if they use and, or they use as interpreted by, or what they do use, it seems to me that and is a different situation than as interpreted by. And all of your cases are really about, if you will, those guidelines that are as interpreted by.
I understand the court's point. I've yet to come across a case that says that the commentary can simply create a freestanding exception, and I'd rely on the cases cited. I realize I'm far over time already.
Why don't we hear from the other side, but we'll make sure you have a chance to respond.
Thank you.
Good morning, Your Honors. May it please the court. Melissa Liu on behalf of the United States. The defendant raises a number of arguments relating to 4B1.2 that are currently before the Supreme Court in Beckles. However, this is not the same as Beckles. This is a 2K2.1 case. And we don't even get to 4B1.2 but for the fact that 2K2.1 incorporates excerpts of 4B1.2 into its definition of a crime of violence.
But the question remains to me whether it might be useful for us to wait till Beckles comes down to see what the court writes.
Yes, I think it could be useful if the court disagrees with the government's interpretation of the 2K2.1 definition of a crime of violence, which is, it says, crime of violence is defined in 4B1.2 and comment 1 to 4B1.2. So it's as if the Sentencing Commission copied portions of those texts and reprinted them in full in comment 1 to 2K2.1, thereby setting them on equal footing. I think that's the appropriate interpretation of that definition.
So how long was he sentenced to, remind me, and when would he be released in the ordinary course of events, and when do we expect the Beckles case to come down?
He was sentenced to 48 months.
Right. And when was that sentence imposed?
I'm sorry, may I?
Yeah, sure.
July 2015.
Okay.
Yes, thank you, Your Honor. It was imposed July 23rd, 2015.
Yeah. So he's a little more than a year in. Okay. A little more than a year into a 4-year sentence.
Yes. Yeah. His estimated release date, I believe, is July 5th, 2017. So yes, I think it could be useful for the court to wait for the Beckles decision. If it disagrees with the government's interpretation of the definition of crime of violence in 2K2.1, noting that Beckles and Soto Rivera, the First Circuit case, deal exclusively with 4B1.2, whereas this is a 2K2.1 case, much like Tate. I'd like to also address the issue of the categorical analysis. The government recognizes that the categorical analysis applies to the guidelines generally, but it applies to cases where there's a matching analysis needed. Here, the text of the definition that we're looking at, specifically that language in Application Note 1 to 4B1.2, really dictates a circumstances-based approach, like the Supreme Court's case Nijuan versus Holder. And in Nijuan, the Supreme Court was looking at this monetary threshold required for a fraud to be an aggravated felony under an immigration statute. And the court noted that there are some statutes or guidelines that refer to a generic crime, and others that refer to a crime as committed on a specific instance. And the court concluded that that particular statute fell in the latter category, and there was no need for a categorical matching analysis. Like that case, the language we're looking at here also falls into that latter category. It's clear that the Sentencing Commission is asking sentencing courts to look at the crime as committed on a particular instance, namely the type of firearm that the defendant unlawfully possessed. And so the government submits that the categorical matching analysis is simply inapplicable to this particular language that we're looking at.
Counsel, what is the significance of the explosive device?
I'm sorry, Your Honor, I'm not sure I understood.
Does it matter that he's not using, not convicted of possession of a gun, but I thought of an explosive device? Although appellant says he wasn't convicted of that. What is the significance here?
Yes, Your Honor. The government does not argue that 922G is not divisible. However, you only have to look at a prior conviction as a complete package under Taylor and Shepard when you're looking to vindicate Sixth Amendment rights. And here, the Sixth Amendment isn't implicated. This is just straightforward judicial fact-finding. And so really, the sentencing guideline requires sentencing courts to look at unlawful possession plus whether or not a person possessed a firearm that falls into this really dangerous category. And so it's not significant for sentencing purposes, the fact that that wasn't an element that the jury necessarily had to find. I'd also like to note that a Molotov cocktail does fall into this category of really dangerous firearms alongside things like rockets and missiles. And so there's really not a concern about judicial fact-finding here because, first of all, the defendant had ample opportunity here to object to the fact of the Molotov cocktail, particularly when 2K2.1 became an issue. And also, one would think that since it is a really dangerous firearm, if he had had a bottle of something else, like a bottle of soda, he probably would have said so. And so there's no concern about that here.
Thank you.
If the court has no further questions, the government respectfully requests that the court affirm defendant's sentence. Thank you.
Thank you. Why don't we put a minute on the clock?
Thank you, Your Honors. Very briefly, in regard to waiting on Beckles, we would ask the court not do that for practical reasons. Beckles, as of this morning, sitting here, has yet to be set for oral argument. So any decision is likely to come at the end of the term, which perhaps June of 2017, which means that this case will become moot since Mr. Barker is set to be released in July of 2017. Also, I don't think Beckles is...
Would it really become moot? That is to say, I understand that he's scheduled for release from custody in July, but I assume that depends on good behavior. And if we were in the end to say that the sentence has to be shorter, would that have any influence on his period of supervised release?
I suppose it could go against bank time on supervised release.
Yeah. So I'm not sure it's moot. It may be a reason not to wait, but I'm not sure. It may be the fact that if he behaves himself, he's likely to be released from the custodial part of the sentence. I think that's maybe a good reason not to wait, but I'm not sure it becomes moot.
I think the other thing is that Beckles is largely a retroactivity case, and I noted that the Supreme Court had to appoint an amicus to even argue that the residual clause under 4B1.2 wouldn't apply. Very briefly, in regard to the issue about the explosive device that Judge Gould had asked about, I did want to point out the government only addresses the constitutional underpinnings of Taylor and DeCamp and ignores the other two underpinnings, namely the textual analysis as well as what Justice Kagan identified as being the fairness equity arguments. In other words, a defendant has no reason to complain about a deficiency, whether it's a Molotov cocktail or whether or not it's another firearm at the time of the conviction. And that's the situation we have here, where the government sets up a false paradigm where it says Mr. Barker could very well have objected to that at the time. There's no reason to, and as Justice Kagan explains, you may very well irk the prosecutor or irk the court if you're arguing about a factual discrepancy that doesn't matter.
Okay.
Thank you. I'm over time again.
Thank both sides for their arguments. United States versus Barker submitted for decision.